దూరవిద్యా విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూరవిద్యా విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బిఏ, బీకాం, బీఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి, డిగ్రీ, డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధనా పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో, టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు, సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University Teleconference. Today, we discuss MA First Year English Literature course, African American Literature. We request the students to participate in this discussion. Please do call us in these telephone numbers 040-270-31431, 040-270-31432, 040-270-31433. It is my pleasure to introduce the eminent resource person for today's program. Professor Gopal Rao sir, retired professor from the Department of English, Usmania University. We welcome you, sir. Professor Lakshmi Narayana sir, retired professor, Department of English, Usmania University. We welcome you for this teleconference, sir. Dear students, today we are going to discuss African American literature. Let us have a bird's eye view what exactly African American literature is. Starting with American literature, that is idealism, we are going towards realism. So starting with Harlem Renaissance, we'll be touching upon black fiction, black poetry and black drama. I am setting the tone with an introduction, reading a few lines from the Unit 20, the book which is prescribed for our MA first year students for American literature. Unit 20, that is the lesson 20, African American literature. Let us start with few introductory lines of how African American literature got a name of African American literature as such. Multi-racism and multiculturalism is a fact of American society. With a sizable black population spread over the entire country, the racial mix and cultural mosaic in the United States are rich and varied. The terms for describing the people of African origin went on changing to suit changing sensitivities of the affected people. Terms like nigger and negro were used by Mark Twain in The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn without causing much offense. But as the colored people became more conscious of their position and their rights in America, the term adopted for them was black people. I quote, it is black people. But the adjective black has an unpleasant connotation. So, once again the description changed to Afro-American, which is further defined to African-American. So, today we will discuss the creative works of African-Americans, their thematic concerns and innovations in language and technique, and the works of few well-known novelists, poets and autobiographies in this brief discussion. Keeping this as a setting tone, now, I request our eminent resource person, Professor Gopal Rao sir, for his comments on how Ralph Emerson gave an information, or we can say like Emerson gave a outlook for idealism. Professor Lakshmi Narayan sir.
Yeah. It's my privilege to address the students and the learners at large. It's an overview we are trying to talk about. First American Renaissance, literary Renaissance starts, New England Renaissance starts in 1829 to 1860 with the father of American literary Renaissance, Emerson, Ralph Waldo Emerson. He is called another name with transcendentalism, which he has initiated. That's purely great idealism they have started. In there with individual freedom and cultural independence, these are the two ideals. There is a philosophical background to this one, that one English philosopher called John Locke said, all our knowledge is possible only through our senses. Senses are the channels of perception, and all our knowledge we get through our senses. But later it was contradicted by another philosopher called Immanuel Kant. He said, no, channels of perception, senses are very limited. There is something called which transcends the senses, which is called intuition, he said, something in you which is intuition. And this idea, and also Emerson is very much influenced by Indian philosophy, Upanishads, Vishnu Purana, all that, and he has come to the conclusion that there is an oversoul, there is intuition, there is something which is indefinable in man, that is the ultimate, the truth of human being. And hence he says, infinite law is within you, man is infinite soul, and nature is symbol of spirit. And who can set limits for human possibilities? That's how he is taking man to the heights of divinity. And that's the reason he says, our day of dependence on learning of other lands comes to a close. Let us stand on our own feet. So, because you are capable of, with your tremendous intuition, your innate power. And that's why he advocates the world is just a shadow of the Oversoul. The world is the other me, he says. And let us now start what he says. Instead of sublime and beautiful, let us go to the near and the low, literature of the poor, and feelings of the child, philosophy of the street, and meaning of household are the topics of the time. So let us walk on our own feet. A nation of men inspired by divine soul also inspires all men. This is a highest level of what you call idealism. He totalizes, he is talking about man. There is no what you call black, white, all that. And later is what disciples like Whitman also repeat, he quote the same feelings. He said, what I assume, you also assume. Every atom belongs to you also equally belongs to you also. In this way, there is what you call non-duality, no discrepancy. And Thoreau also is another disciple, said that these people, the government thinks that if they imprison me, they think that they are imprisoning my bones, flesh, blood, but they don't know I am not bone, flesh and blood. I am much more than that. So in this way, Emerson has started a very, very, what you call, idealistic, the divine, innate divinity of man he started. This is what he started. This is the idealism. Yeah.
So
he is totalizing man. He is not a discriminant of black, white, all that.
In total. So, coming with Emerson and Immanuel Kant, let us go to the second renaissance in prose writers, for example, in 1920s. What is the significance and impact of American second renaissance, Professor Gopal Rao, sir?
Now, the American renaissance of the 1920s is one of the landmark achievements, and particularly we have a great impact of the writers dominated by Ernest Hemingway, Sherwood Anderson, Sinclair Lewis, E. Cummings, and Scott Fitzgerald. In fact, two of the great Nobel laureates come from the 1920s, Sinclair Lewis and Hemingway. And this is the beginning of the second Renaissance, which brought about a cultural, literary changes. A great deal of variety of experimentation has gone into their works. And what a tremendous output indeed. The age is known for its lost generation, as one of the finest statements made by Miss Gertrude Stein, that became a catchword, a kind of a phenomenon that dominated the age of nihilism, sense of nothingness, which is called nada, and in fact has been a loss of self and loss of, you know, a kind of a disillusionment, mental dissipation became one of the most important themes of the 20s. And of course we have a period of great experimentation, and we have, as what Eliot talks about in Wasteland, the presiding deity of the 1920s, he says that there is sexual degradation and spiritual vacuum is the theme of the 1920s. And as Miss Gertrude Stein said, you're all a lost generation looking at Hemingway. So 20s highlighted the failure of religion, culture, family values, and the psyche and the morale of the entire generation was on the downward stream. As one of the greatest classic comments made by Eliot at that point of time, he says that the whole of Europe has been struck by a psychological blow, and people have not recovered from that shock. The whole of mankind seems to be standing on the brink of abyss, the depth of which no man can presume. Everybody seems to be living under the shadow the suspended sentence of death, and that is the theme of the 1920s, the literature highlighted by these people. In fact, Hemingway stands tall among all these contemporaries. He's called the 20th century Lord Byron, a man who wrote his fiction with superb conviction, extraordinary indeed by any stretch of imagination.
So it's a pleasure, like we started with idealism, then we are going towards realism, blacks. So it's idealism represents American literature, whereas the black realism, it's like a continuation. So keeping this in the scenario, how do you think like Harlem Renaissance made an impact in the starting of American, Afro-American literature? What is the impact of Harlem Renaissance?
We have Harlem Renaissance during early 20th century, a new creative consciousness emerging. A new cultural movement was on, from slavery to self-assertive state is unfolding. The old Negroes were, in the olden days, the Negroes were hunted and they were brought with chains and brought to the market and they were being sold. And that was the most inhuman practice, man against man, because of their color of the skin, they were being, you know, sold like commodities. And then there was what you call an awakening, black awakening. Civil rights movement came and the people began to think of their, what you call, selfhood. They are searching for their roots. And a new vigorous creativity making waves, and that's called what you call Black Renaissance. You may call the Harlem Renaissance. There are innumerable names, and the major voice of that movement, Zora Neale Hurston, and there are many. So that's as Madam has put it, African American, they have acquired what you call, they wanted to retain their roots, they got this hyphenated identity, African American. They wanted Indian American. So as you said, the multiculturalism, so they wanted their personal, their identity, their roots back. So that's the reason
we started with it. Yeah, coming into this point, it started like initially they are called as Negroes, then the niggers, then it is coined as black, then they said Afro-American, then they said this is African-American literature or African-American. There is, as you said, quote unquote African-American. How do the civil rights movement and Black is Beautiful kind of movements gave an impact, their impact on literature, especially on Black literature, Professor Gopal Rao sir?
Black movement, I think, started with one of the greatest civil rights leader, the champion of the civil rights movement in the United States, and he had the blessings of Robert Kennedy, who in fact encouraged him to go about it and brought about a lot of change in the thinking. In fact, Harlem Renaissance begins with Jim Crow's legislation where black people are not allowed to stay in the main colonies or the main cities. They're only narrowed down to one place called Manhattan, and unfortunately they had to go through the ordeals of suffering and being put to a lot of discomfort, and they face a lot of social condemnation. I think Hollywood film Mississippi Burning captures this kind of a elevated sense of rejection and also atrocities perpetrated on them. And in fact, Malcolm X played a very important role in taking out the cudgels and picking the gauntlet and taking the fight into the enemy camp. In fact, he did a tremendous work. And in fact, Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali joined. That movement became very popular, and Malcolm X became a household name in America. But significantly, I Have a Dream, that wonderful speech, I think goes down in memory lane, the way he articulated that speech, expressing the agony of the black people of a particular generation who really was suffocating under the pressures of the white domination. Afro-Americans felt that here is a man who brought new life, kind of an extension of a new lease of life, and brought about a new ideology, and a remarkable mass struggle was taken up. And of course, Malcolm X, as well as Martin Luther King. In fact, King received many citations, representative of the Afro-American background, and he did a splendid job in trying to take the fight to such an extent, to its logical conclusion, and brought about a dynamic change in the outlook of the people who suffered for a very long time.
Yeah, keeping these themes, whatever that it can be, starting with black movement, Black is Beautiful, and the civil rights movement, how the prominent writers, James Baldwin and Zora Nelson, they rise are watching God, and Toni Morrison, Alice Walker, what are they, the take home point from that point of time, from the civil rights movement, Professor Lakshmi Narayan sir?
Yeah. There is what you call this cultural commotion. There is a creative, what you call convulsions. Now it is turning, whole cultural turning is taking place. And now James Baldwin, which is again, we have something because they are the pioneers. So they cannot have that, what you call militancy, that assertive, that what you call that powerful
They
don't have, but they are trying to initiate something. They are the pioneers of the new movement, the black, how to fight the white man. But the enormous establishment, their might, their power, we cannot fight it out. What to do? So Baldwin is in his very prominent novels, Nobody Knows My Name, Another Country, Fire Next Time, No Name in the Street. These are the very representative writings. Baldwin's main thesis is that the white man suffers from insecurity. That is the reason he tries to dominate over us. So, what to do? So, the only way he suggests is, let us love him, let us overcome him with love. This is a very, very typical Indian way of, you know, very mild, very, very down-to-earth thing. He said that if the white man suffers from fear, panic, insecurity, so only way is to have love and get integrated in the mainstream. This idea he starts in his first book called, in his book called Fire Next Time. But when he happens to, as our Professor Gopal Rao said, there is what you call militancy, there is what you call commotion, there is going to be what you call head-on collision, all that. So, now there is a changing position, and now he, in his next novel, No Name in the Street, his idealism wears off, and also he joins that what you call militancy movement, and he is now one with this. He expresses his solidarity with these people to get our rights. That is the what you call metamorphosis, transformation in James Baldwin.
Coming to Ralph Ellison, what is his contribution straight away from the black movement, or what is the take-home point from for him?
Ralph Ellison, I think, brought about a great change, historical change, particularly the invisible man that he is talking about. And he has actually brought about, it's a novel which reflects a raft of hope, and also it's a kind of a talking about the injustice perpetrated by the majority white community, and through his black suffering, that he is able to bring about a kind of a special ideology that we are living in a very unfair world. In a perfect world, we should accept people for what they are and who they are. And then, you know, in an imperfect world, there is no point in telling the truth, because people will never understand you. Invisibility, or passing and lying about one's identity, is quite absurd. But in the society that chooses not to tolerate difference, invariably brings about other dangers. So he talks about even civil rights movements, and he was an active proponent of that particular thing. And social realism becomes a symbolism of the Afro-American who has to go in search or quest for his identity in a no man's land, where there is no scope for enlargement of his own personality, because he has to face the vicissitudes of different impositions by the white man, and find it's very difficult to extricate himself from this kind of a dubious situation. And therefore, he says, don't watch me by the color of my skin, watch me by what I am. And this is what he's trying to say. I may be invisible to you, but judge me what I am. I have the potential, I have the capacity in my own way to challenge you. I'm ready to fight, and I'm ready for a real big fight. Pick the gauntlet and take my fight to the enemy camp. It speaks about the indomitable courage of this man, unflinching faith in broad humanism.
Yes. Extending what Professor Gopal Rao said on Ralph Ellison. Yeah. Invisible, why I am invisible? Because he says, people refuse to see me. People refuse to see me. To be invisible is, why man is invisible? Because he has to take the opinions of the majority of the people, ideas of the people. He is of not himself. He is of different self. So I am nobody. So I am invisible. To be invisible is again a positive connotation, that to be pervasive, to be invisible is transcending space and time, and to pervasive, and that's the reason. And also he talks of, in any metropolis, a man becomes naturally invisible. And also he talks of what you call, what else man can do. He could to sustain our will to preserve but laughter. Only that is the only way we can have. And In the novel, we see his own teacher, Bledsoe, gives him a very dubious letter, recommendation letter. In that, he writes hypocrisy, and he writes that this boy should not be employed anywhere. When he opens it, it's what you call, he betrays him. And when he goes to a factory, he gets appointed. That is a very ironically what you call optic white factory. And there, by mistake, he mixes both white and black. And see, that's a very highly symbolic, you know. The mixing black and white is something very symbolic of the integration of black and white. And the white people become very angry and they fire him. And you know, they always say the white is right. White is right.
And might.
Yeah, that is the thing. And then he goes to another place called Brotherhood. Brotherhood is left movement, which is having, they always want violence. They always want detonate and all that. So somehow it goes against his grain. He doesn't want to fit into that Brotherhood. And later he leaves, and his identity becomes almost questionable, and they are hounding of this man. He is very, very suspicious. Then he wears black goggles and then hat, and what called Reinhardt, he puts his name. Reinhardtism comes to have many identities. And then, you know, when he was going, he happens to see on the streets of New York, the racial rights are on, very violent racial rights are on. What to do? Where to hide? Then he goes into the manhole. That's highly symbolic, you know. That's where he is going deep into the motherhood, the womb of the mother, to protect himself.
Yeah.
And that's a very, that is one of the very great symbolic significance we have in Rolf Ellison. And also, Rolf Ellison has another wonderful experience. He says, when binaries are being blurred, where is white, where is black? And he says, all oppressed are black, he says. And he says, on another point, who may say, from lower frequencies, I speak for you. From lower frequencies, I speak for you. You are, whether black or white, whoever is oppressed, I speak for you. On that note, he ends, and this is a very celebrated, great novel, considered by all standards, all critics.
That's the Invisible Man.
Invisible Man.
Adding to that, yes.
The novel is also a story about pain and suffering, and also he advocates that there is every possibility that America should embrace multiculturalism, pluralism. In fact, the anticipation of the Marxist movement and tendencies in the 1940s and 50s, which culminated in many of the Hollywood directors and screenplay writers were abandoned and left in the lurch. And Trumbo, one of the greatest screenplay writers whom Kirk Douglas encouraged, came onto the scene and brought about a change. The perception of the communist ideology, which plagued not only Hollywood, but many creative artists like Ralph Ellison, were absolutely marginalized and sent out. But even Baldwin takes about a different stand on this and very strongly pleads for a case that one should have the capacity to resist and fight on with a tremendous zeal and zest to overcome all these odds.
Yeah. Taking this point as symbolism, as you said, sir, I remember Toni Morrison's novel, The Bluest Eye, where the bottom land, the bottom
hill.
Land, yeah, the top of the hill is
hill.
Called as bottom
yes.
land, where you can't have any, the fertile land is not available, but it is given to the black people
exactly.
as a gift to the black. So this kind of comparisons we can see between black writers, like whether it can be in Ralph Ellison's or Toni Morrison, even in Alice Walker. Can you give some more examples from Toni Morrison?
She is Toni Morrison is a very celebrated writer, and her vision is very unique. She is not stereotyped, what you call fighting the black people. This is all overdone and it's been going on. But at the same time, she talks of she upholds the dignity of black woman, how she is very embodiment of patience, very embodiment of suffering, her bond with her family, to be a motherhood she talks of, she celebrates motherhood. And there are two examples which let us ponder over them, what exactly she is trying to, how to, and even with that, she is seeking for female self, female identity. You find her motherhood in one of the incidents. We find that her daughter, when she catches fire, she jumps from the second floor and protects, hugs her daughter, and she extinguishes the fire, and she shows her mother. And very differently, her son, who was totally made disabled in the war, has lost his manhood and has become a cripple, and he crawls on the ground, on the floor. No, he's undergoing tremendous trauma, torture, bodily torture. So she cannot bear. One day, one night, she pours kerosene and she ignites. She sets ablaze and he dies. And he is back into the silence of that motherhood. He goes back. And there you have these two symbols, show us very, very contrasting pictures of motherhood of Alice Walker.
Yes, Tony
Morrison. We can draw much conclusions from that.
Yes.
What a great mother she is trying to portray, Tony Morrison.
The most important thing to remember from Tony Morrison is one of the great classic work, Beloved, 1987, and then of course she won the Pulitzer Award 1988, and 25 years later the American Academy of Arts has given her one of the most powerful, you know, comment that she seems to be one of the greatest ever African American to have brought about such a change in the outlook of the perspective of the white people. And Beloved, the novel, had generated tremendous heat and dust, and many critics have come forward to say it's one of the finest novels to come out of the American ruckus-stricken American bosom. And in fact, it told a very harsh commentary on the slavery, and how a mother, Margaret Garner, seems to save a two-year-old child from returning to slavery, and how she fights back. I think she's an institution by herself, a woman of high caliber, vision, wisdom, and known for her unshakable integrity of mind. And in fact, we have so much of, you know, her works are steeped in African American languages, local dialects and music, everyday life, and the cultural patterns which are a part and parcel of her great inheritance. And in fact, she talks a lot about Jim Crow legislation, how the Reconstruction process in America has gone through and brought about several ordeals of consciousness, and how the lives of women have been affected. And she goes into the unexplored, the uncharted areas of human experience. And she indeed, talks about the eliminating factors of the mother to murder her child is one of the most ironic situations, but yet she fought on. And the novel today stands out along with Color Purple, which was made into a Hollywood film. And these two stand out as remarkable testaments for great Afro-American women to have come out and stood their ground to reaffirm the sense of affirmativeness.
Coming to this point,
so
I feel
I want to make myself. That's what she
sees in that.
Shall we make some?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Adding to that point, when Toni Morrison's novels are women-centered, mm-hmm. because the naming here, mm-hmm. It starts with in Sula, novel Sula, mm-hmm. Sula Peace, Hana Peace, and Eva Peace.
Yeah.
So it's a peace-centered women world. Mm-hmm. Whereas she is a giver of life and at the same time she is a taker of life. That's what we can see. She gives life to the child, girl child, the girl who is going to fall from the second building. And she is going to take the son's life. She says like, there is enough of space in my womb when you are a child. But after growing up and you became a waste and you are you are a veteran and now you are no more useful, not of that potent. There is no enough space in my womb that you can crawl back. So she is a giver of life as well as a taker of life.
Very fine.
Coming to that point, this is a search for self and a gentle and firm identity we can see in Sula also. In a story, if I remember, that is also symbolic, if I am right. She chops off her little finger and says to threaten the black boy, if I can do this to myself, what do you think I can do for you? So it's like a celebration of her own sisterhood and celebration of self, and it is a strong and firm identification with the community. So self and community go together in her novels. So coming back to Alice,
I would like to add one point.
Please.
The novel has been looked about from critical lens, the psychoanalytical as well as, you know, concept of neo, you know, communist ideology and the body, motherhood and world history, memory. And how do you look at this text being looked from neo-Marxist angle?
Yes.
That's one question that always troubled me to understand how this text can be reinterpreted from neo-Marxist ideological point of view. As a Marxist feminism is at the top on the list of all the critics who talked about this novel.
Yes. So coming back, I'm just pondering upon this. She says like, personal is political and political is personal. So in that way, we can see in the Marxist, maybe in a very then a overistic point of view. So how do you compare Alice Wacker with Toni Morrison? What are the similarities or the themes that are intertwined in their writings?
Yeah, but Alice Walker is more concerned about her obsession almost with history. What happened to our mothers, what happened to our grandmothers, how much of enormous suffering they had undergone, what enormous suffering they had undergone. Because today we are very conscious, very assertive, very modern, very we have tremendous movements and all that. But those women, our mothers and our grandmothers, were, they were the puppets in the hands of white people. And she says they were sexual objects, helpless sexual objects and mule of the world. And she says, and in her vivid description, she says, they enter loveless marriages without joy and became prostitutes without resistance and became mothers, children without fulfillment. This is the what you call predicament of their mothers, grandmothers, how they end. During that, she recalls the Virginia Woolf's A Room of One's Own, and Philip Wheatley, and Nella Larson, Zora Huston, and how this Wheatley dies of malnutrition and mental agony. And in search of, in her work called In Search of My Mother's Garden. She ends, in search of my mother's garden, I found my own.
That's a search for self. Coming into this point.
In fact, the most important book that influenced Alice Walker's works is Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Are Watching God. It's, I think, a seminal work that brought about a change in her outlook to life, love, sex, and all these kind of things. It's a lesbian novel. It's one of the finest lesbian novels where two women are involved in a relationship and silly and shug the blues singer in a nightclub, alters and offers tremendous possibilities for the variations. We're looking for someone who can reciprocate her love. And Ellie, in fact, Sally, likes her because she's able to give her that kind of much needed comfort, a kind of a different kind of sexual pleasure, and the kind of, you know, relating to, you know, her own desire to go out into the world and seek her own liberatory, her love for sister Nettie, and the lesbianism as a liberating experience. And Color Purple really takes the cake in bringing out a positive outlook, getting away from the patriarchal dynamics, and a liberating spirit of woman yearning for a better life, freedom from oppression. And she's no longer a sex object, and her body being a site of violation by male and hegemony, and she tries to defy all that and eventually find Shug and Seeley going through a wonderful experience. And the novel is a very positive affirmation that androgynous and heterosexual dynamics are at interplay and giving a broad scope for women to enjoy and have more sexual pleasure.
Yes.
So how do you react to this? Female bonding.
We can see in a different way, like when it comes to Pilot in Sons, and whether it can be in the Toni Morrison's, it's a celebration of sisterhood in one way. Because when we see in The Bluest Eye, Pecola Breedlove, where 10 years old child, she is alienated from her own community, whereas there is no sisterhood celebrated. When it comes to the second novel, Sula, we can see like it's a women-centered, where all women play vital role. Coming to the third one, Song of the Solomon, where we can see like Pilate is a very unique character, we can Solomon's aunt, where again a community and the sisterhood, whereas the brotherhood and sisterhood is always celebrated hand in hand with each other. This is altogether a different, takes a different end when it comes to Beloved. It is here she is a mother and she sacrifices her own daughter for the sake of coming out of the clutches of the slavery. So seeing in this point of view, in this perception, I mean this viewpoint, there is a difference between we can see the intertwining between the community, between the women and even men in the community. So there is an intertwining. Yes, we should agree like it is evolving. We can see that it's not only about men, women, but even other. Here the other plays a vital role, where it includes LGBT, and many of the novels talk about lesbian relations and bisexual and gay also. So the literatures reflected after 1970s, we can see that the latest novel, I think, Love of Toni Morrison, again speaks volumes of different kind dimensions of engagements of women in different relationships. That's what my observation.
Is it not to overcome alienation?
Yes, rootlessness.
Yeah.
Yes, rootlessness.
Because you feel so lonely, alienated. Whom to talk to? Whom to embrace? Whom to, reciprocate love? So the familial relations are in the form of bonding, and in the form of, as you said, sisterhood. That could be maybe
one of the reason for that, it is not directly related to our African American literature. Mm-hmm. We see the same kind of similarities in diaspora writing. Mm-hmm. Indian literature, diaspora mm-hmm. writers, mm-hmm. Bharti Mukherjee's novel,
Chitra Devakar.
Even many of the writers, displacement, rootlessness, alienation from their homeland, and they're going to come back, revisit in their own revisiting, and I think that is what displayed or in their novels are. We think like diaspora writing is also comes under that kind of.
Well, the title of this novel itself is the celebration of the heroism of the black women, and how they were able to find not only beauty and the pleasure of life, but also celebration, which is at the central spiritual level, to go for personal growth, enhancement of personal growth becomes one of the most important factors in that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe I think it is a mode of reclaiming, repossessing their roots. They want to have back to the roots, and for that they try to bond with their own community, creating their own community when they are alienated from the mainstream, marginalized from the mainstream. So that maybe that's the reason.
Even subaltern study speaks about subaltern. That. Yeah. No, so shifting from literature to a little bit for the 1940s. So how do you see African war fiction in 1940? How is it black writers or black literature? Yes, 1940s, after that it's post-war. So 1940s, American war fiction.
Yeah, American war fiction is a special entity by itself. And I think it one of the best war novels have come out of that particular period. And we have on the top of the list, we have Norman Mailer's Naked and the Dead, James Jones' From Here to Eternity, which has made into a great Hollywood film starring Frank Sinatra. And also we have one of the finest novel is God of Honor. And we have Herman Vaughan's Caine Mutiny. And of course, we have the great war novel, Spanish war novel, From Whom the Bell Tolls. When these novels have set fire to any great, at great length, bringing about the turmoil and the war machinery, blood joining, the splattered blood utopia, the blood splattered utopia, as it's called, brought about enormous destruction. One of the greatest madmen of Europe, Hitler, with the devastating power of the military machine, trembled upon everything. We have another great war novel, Enormous Room by E.E. Cummings, and then of course we have Das Passos, Three Soldiers. But I think Norman Mailer's Naked and the Dead is a vivid portrayal. Even the Jews working in the American army were put to so much of mental agony. And we have here the great American general Cummins, who tries to destroy the integrity of one of the finest virtuous soldier to have come out of the Second World War, Lieutenant Hearn, a man of stored with intellectual powers, a man endowed with great class and culture, and who seems to be on a patrolling duty on the Japanese side of the border. And coming out of his fascist tendencies, what Mailer is trying to do is very outspoken critic of the American armed forces. And it says that there are fascists in the military system, the top brass of the army, the generals for fascists. And wonder, the soldier wonders, am I fighting the enemy or fighting my own generals? The generals look like, not generals, but like ordinary businessmen with the middle finger adoring diamond rings and pot shots, bellies. Look at this kind of irony that Second World War becomes one of the most important crucible for test, with the great writers with their creative imagination brought out wonderful novels, From Here to Eternity, God of Honor, Caine Mutiny. We have to divide the war novels into two sections, pro-war novelists, anti-war novelists. And Norman Mailer is a pro-war novelist, fought to fight to rid the disease of fascism, and how the military machine is not able to destroy the concepts of liberalism and democracy. And we have Fable to Arms again by Hemingway, one of the greatest classics, starring Rock Hudson and Jennifer Jones, brings about this particular truth, that there is no romantic affirmation. At the end of it, there is nihilism. There is nothingness.
Alienation.
Absolutely nothingness. Yeah. Whom the bell tolls. Hemingway went all the way to Spain to fight the war, and this one man fight against the entire military machine of the generalist Somo, Franco, and it's been a bloody war where thousands of people perished. Each and every war novel is written by great writers who dip their pen not in ink but in blood, tears and acid. Yeah. We have the acid realism coming out of it, and I'm a great lover of some of the great Hollywood movies made on war and how the military machine has destroyed every vantage point. And The Dirty Dozen is a classic example of that.
Now we will come to the post-war American novel.
Yes.
That's really very, very, very significant achievement, because the war has brought in a trail of destruction, despair, nihilism. And what the great celebrated man, Eliot, says, history, he says, immense panorama of futility and waste, that is contemporary history. And we see the impact of the war has created whole the writers who are really trying to give us what happened to man, what happened to this world. The world is nothing but we are caught up in a, what you call, a endless expanse of uncountable universe. Man cannot know himself what is happening. He is caught up in a absurd, chaotic world. War is a, what you call, moral failure, cultural anarchy. And a great novelist called Joseph Heller, in his Catch 22, very celebrated work, it's called a classic of modern classic. And in that he shows how men are mad, how they give combating duties to the captains, and how youngsters are being killed, and the whole bloodshed. And then we see the world is totally, he talks of, from war, he talks of the whole macrocosm. He says the world is nothing but there are no, it is devoid of guiding principles, and man is left alone, and no more it is a place habitable. The world is no more habitable. It is a living hell. And Heller tries to bring in what you call the central fact of human existence is man is a victim hero. But at the same time he says he transcends his victim condition by enduring, by confronting. So he becomes a hero. A victim hero emerges after the
war. Post-war.
Yeah. So then we have another very important writer called Kurt Vonnegut. And we have another novelist called Ken Casey. He brings in the macrocosm, the lunatic asylum, wherein you have a big nurse, Rachel, and she monitors how the organization's totalitarian structures and the institutions thin out human personality, how man is being dwindled, reduced to nothingness. And in this you have, the world has become a lunatic asylum, he says, and where the hero, you know, he is subjected to lobotomy, what you call electric shock. And finally, the whole novel is becomes a total of what you call the laughter is the living principle, but beneath the laughter, because the facade of the whole novel, you find deep pathos, human tragedy, human predicament. And this post-war novelists have brought out a tremendous creativity, which is
creativity with pain, agony, suffering reflected in their narrative technique as well as the themes.
Point I would like to make is that both Joseph Heller and Ken Casey have presented, they are the representatives of the counterculture movement in America. When John F. Kennedy became the president, he brought about the great euphoria among the Americans, and he was regarded as a prince author trying to liberate his people from the oppressive tendency. Unfortunately, after the death of Kennedy, there has been a very oppressive movement that destroyed individualism in America. And he said the individual versus the forces of combined. And how Joseph Heller's hero, Bessarion, looks at the whole scenario. At one point of time, he says, am I a sane person living in an insane world? It's all a bloody absurd world turned upside down. In fact, the stunning revelation of the role of military hierarchy is questioning. It's trying every effort because your sovereign is stationed in one of the bases in Japan and he wants to avoid to go there and bomb. He said, why should I? I don't want to risk my life. And for what reason? For a goddamn reason, they've got to die and no heroism left. It's not about heroism, about common sense that I should live long enough to fight some other day, but not today. I choose the time and date of my death, not foolhardiness to jump and run away and then get killed. And he is talks about the absurdity, helplessness of an individual caught in an organized society of regimentation. And he says, my life is more precious. And the catch 22 is an attack on the contemporary regimented society and army as an institution which has robbed the individualism. When you go back to Ken Kesey's One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, I think that novel has set ablaze several institutional and moralistic approaches.
One second. A Usurian escapes from war. That is again very significant. He escapes from war and goes to Sweden. That is very metaphorical. A Sweden, neutral Sweden, where you have what you call, Sweden is a place of sanity. Place of sanity, from insanity to sanity. And your personal life is more precious than getting killed in any, because we are adrift in a world of absurdity. So let us escape. Escapism is escape of heroism, heroism of escape. That's not getting killed like a, what you call a dog in a war. That is escape, yeah. Is the most, yeah, motif of the novel.
Yeah. Now, taking these points.
I would like to add something. Ken Kesey's novel brought about a great revolution. He's talking about the asylum where you have people who are helpless, being trampled by the authoritarian forces represented by big nerds, and here comes the hero into the scene and tries to bring sanity into the lives of people. And Jack Nicholson played that role. It's all about the Chief Bromden, an American Indian who's been a part of this, has been watching very deftly, and he brings out one important lesson. To be a pretender in the world is better, and wear a disguise and don't show your true identity. He fights back, and towards the end, he breaks the whole control systems, escapes from the asylum as a free man into the Indian Restoration Territory, where he could be able to bring about his spontaneous self into action. The novel is all about trying to redefine the sense of freedom. Recalcitrance is the badge of courage. Fight on, be defiant, and go against system. And towards then, Mac Murphy becomes a victim of lobotomy, but he sacrifices. And for what? To liberate all those birds who are in a kind of a pigeonhole, and give them wings to fly and go on and on. That's all about liberation, about Mac Murphy.
Laughter becomes the affirmation of life.
Yes.
One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest is the laughter
yes,
and
yes.
laughter. That is the tremendous affirmation of life. On this note, we'll
conclude, sir. So, dear students, we had a fruitful discussion on African-American literature with our eminent scholars, eminent resource persons, Professor Gopal Rao sir and Professor Lakshmi Narayana sir. With this, one more small information to you. These books are for your reference. This is African-American literature. And the second book is African and Afro-American Literature. African and Afro-American Literature. You can please go to the Unit 20 of MA previous. There's one more last book, African Literature. This is an anthology. It will be very useful for your reference. Hope this discussion was fruitful for you. And we had a bird's eye view on African-American literature. Thank you very much for your patience listening. Thank you.